why should one realize a common presentation of original piano compositions of Franz Liszt and his transcription of excerpts from the operas of Richard Wagner on the 200th anniversary of Richard Wagner this year and 2 years ago in connection with Liszt's birth, knowing that Liszt strongly influenced Wagner as a composer and that Wagner, after 1876, overshadowed Liszt's central importance in European music by the creation of Wagner's shrine of self-idolatry in Bayreuth. One of my main reasons to do some justice to Liszt and to make clear his uniqueness as a composer, as a generous companion and financial supporter of Wagner, as an avant-garde composer, in spite of very different concept of the music, social behavior, especially towards women, and character. I repeat, Liszt was Wagner's generous companion, but not his close friend. Liszt wanted to realize his idea of music in connection with the other arts and events in his life as an elevation of a future society through his idea of poetic music in the concert hall. He rejected opera and the stage as too limited for his big visions. Wagner considered opera as his medium for the total work of art. He created all the details of his scores, music, libretto, all details of the sets and stage directions. He also dominated the reception of his stage works by his own theories, theater, and propaganda publication, the so-called Bayreuther Blätter, quite the opposite of Liszt. Wagner wanted to dominate and manipulate his public. He saw himself as the greatest genius in human history and the savior of mankind. Wagner was the most egomaniacal artist of his time. He tolerated no one except himself, and the after effects of his attitude still resound today. Liszt, too, was a vain man, but he did not present himself as the savior of mankind through his art. His composition and public writings and letters are full of artistic fire, but moderate and generous towards all composers, colleagues, past and present. Some of the reasons why they were very different, sometimes even strange companions, both in the creation of their compositions and as human beings, can be discovered by reading carefully the correspondence between the two men. Let's concentrate now on Liszt's piano version of Les Préludes, which had a strong impact on Richard Wagner's composer. And Wagner then also wrote on this in a very important speech and also writing called Symphonic Poems. Wagner wrote in 1847, "With Liszt, this masterly grip in the musical conception speaks out with such a power at the very outset of the piece that after the first six bars, I often could not restrain the astonished cry, 'Enough, I have it all.' This I deem so prominent a feature in the works of Liszt that, despite of his aversion shewed by the certain party to recognize Liszt's power in this field, I haven't the slightest fear as to their finding the very speedy entrance to the affections of the public power. The difficulties which stand in the way of dramatic compositions due to the far greater complexity of their media of expression are smaller in the case of more purely orchestral works. Our bands are mostly good, and Liszt himself, or one of his more familiar pupils, can conduct the performances, the same success will always follow, as Liszt found, with our simple-hearted people, who so touchingly expressing their astonishment that composition, which they had warned against the formless and chaotic, should have struck them as so swift and easy of understanding. Now I will speak on Franz Liszt's Les Préludes, the version for two hands. Les Préludes is the third of Franz Liszt's 13 symphonic poems. It was first conducted by Liszt himself in April 1856. The score and the orchestral parts were published in January 1865 by the famous publishing house Breitkopf & Härtel of Leipzig. Among Liszt's symphonic poems, Les Préludes is the most popular. The full title, Les Préludes d'après Lamartine, refers to the ode of Adolphe, and we see here him on the right side, Lamartine Nouvelle Méditation Poétique. The published score also includes a preface, which was not written by Lamartine, but by various, by different authors, including the second very important figure, lady in the life of Liszt, by Caroline, Duchess of Wittgenstein. Officially, Les Préludes was based on Alphonse de Lamartine's long poem of the same name. And one can hear a relationship between Liszt's music and Lamartine's account of life as a series of preludes leading up to death, the main event. This episodic structure seems to depict such a series with each episode, or prelude stand with its own distinct character. Moreover, when the most famous passage in Les Préludes, familiar to most of us from having heard it in countless movies and science fiction serials, returns near the end, we sense the heroic tone of the affirmation of an indomitable life force. Liszt undoubtedly renamed the peace party to trade on Lamartine's greater name recognition and such higher artistic quality. But the change also reflects his transformation of the earlier overture of a mere collection of contrasting themes into a more continuous and focused sequence of musical events, which could and may the sense of narrative involving epic forces. It was one of the perverse political brutalities of the Third Reich that during World War II, the fanfare motif of the march final was made in the signature of tune for the Wehrmacht Bericht Radio Report and the Deutsche Wochenschau Real News. During World War II, Les Préludes was perverted into the melody of death in the sense of phrases Nazi ideology. Long before this occurred, Liszt gave this piece a different significance, and we should know here very well and read what he wrote. A man cannot live without taking part in dangerous battles, without asking for reason, and he may have even lost and even sometimes die. He leaves the listener enough space for their own reflection. Even the different versions of the preface will not change Liszt's intention as a poetic composer. This much more open and general vision has to do with Liszt's poetic music, as inspired by the poetry, his reflections, and its contents, his interpretation and musical transformation in his own Les Préludes. The act of presenting to you the solo piano version of Liszt's Prélude is related to his own very creative challenge of transforming orchestral masterpieces of importance, of important colleagues of his time, like he did, among others, with Berlioz. Now we have the privilege to hear this masterpiece. I think I like it a lot, in the interpretation of my dear friend Idil, and I'm very pleased to bring her to the piano.
Thank you. Thank you.